Chad, would you come tell us about Jesus?
It's always good to come to the Rock. No other place like it in the world, can I tell you? Hey, if you want to sit down here in the front, you're more than welcome. In fact, it's always a pleasure for me to have the aisles crowded with teenagers. Most of the time I find myself in a foreign country. It's very rare that I do anything in the U.S. You can be seated. Thank you very much. But if you say, man, I need some stretching room, there's plenty of stretching room down here. I want to thank Luke, Pastor Dan, Jim and Debbie, and Dr. Barron. ISOM is probably watching online. Hey, Dr. Barron. Dr. Barron's in Africa doing some graduations. Always good to know that we're going around the world. Good to be here. Tonight's topic is a little different. It's not something that you hear people talk about very often. You just don't, especially in this environment. In fact, I think it's interesting that because of the epidemic, as the U.S. government calls it, of suicide, you don't see more people talking about it in the church. And understand that there's a lot of things that go in with that. There's a lot of shame. There's a lot of embarrassment. There's a lot of confusion. You know, whenever you begin to talk about things that involve the mind, Joel, you know this, in dealing with people with Breaking Free, is it becomes a gray area. People get nervous. People get scared. And let me just first say that I'm not a doctor. I'm not a psychiatrist. I'm not a licensed therapist. I'm somebody who loves teenagers, and I love Jesus. And I just want to share some truth with you. Yep. Tonight is different, as you know. Dr. Barron and the ISOM team, we partnered together to create Youth Bites. And one of the things that we did is we create video tools, and we decided to take on suicide. I'll talk more about that as I get into this. But just know tonight's going to be a little different. I am going to show you a clip from the video. And let me just say this ahead of time, that if you have a child in here who is 12 years and younger, let's just say younger than 12 years, as that video comes on, we're just going to ask you on behalf of the pastoral staff, you may not want to go ahead and just let the child, maybe take them to the foyer, take them to play in the grounds outside. It's a graphic video, and you know, I understand that what kids see on television and on media today, this may pale in comparison, but I just want to honor you as parents. I don't want you to put your child in a situation to see something that may cause you grief later in the evening. Yes? Okay, let's talk about suicide. And I feel strange saying that, but it's something that needs to be talked about. Suicide is one of those things that has such a shroud around it. It's been relegated to the backside of the church. It's been relegated to the backside of media. Most professionals will tell you it's something they don't really want to talk about. But when something of this magnitude comes and hits home in our community, in our friends, my children's friends, and some of these areas that are very personal to us, it begins to let me realize that we're in a battle. It's a fight that's going on. And there is a battle for the life and the soul and the call of a generation. And Satan and the system in which we live knows no limits and will push the envelope as much as it can to discourage and to come after our young people. I looked up the definition today on a fight and a battle. And it basically, in definition in Webster's, it says, a fight or a struggle to use weapons or physical force to try to hurt someone, to defeat someone. A struggle or a battle in a physical or a spiritual combat. And I don't know if you've watched the news lately, but we're in a spiritual battle in this country. There is a lot going on the invisible and the invisible side of things that really have more of an influence on us and on our children than we could ever imagine. Let me just get these three things and I'll begin to go. This is a fight for more than a generation. This is a fight for you personally. Do you realize it? This is a fight for you. This is a fight for your children. This is a fight for your grandchildren. This is a fight for your nieces and nephews. This is a fight for our future. It's a fight for our kids. And let me begin with these two scriptures. In 2 Corinthians, it says, for we war not in the flesh, but we war according to the flesh. But the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but are mighty for the pulling down of strongholds. Though we may walk in this world, though we may be a part of it, the weapons that we use are not based on a series of natural laws. Do you realize that? Is that we've been given weapons that are supernatural, that are able to overcome even some of the most difficult circumstances that we find ourselves in. Joel, you and I could shout back and forth at each other when we see the Word of God do what nothing else can do in a person's life. Hebrews 4 says that the Word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It's able to divide and to go inside of a person and to lay open and to lay bare the person's motivations. What's going on? What are the problems? And understand the Bible says that in the beginning the Word became flesh. Who is that sword? It's Jesus. So know those scriptures going into it. Talking about suicide, I took a number of notes. In fact, it's difficult for me at times because there's so much information I feel like I want to get out to you so that you can understand, but I just pared it down into bite-sized pieces. How's that? We'll break it down into bite-sized pieces. John 10:10, you know the scripture. Jesus said, "The thief has come to steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come to give you life and to give you life more abundantly." Understand, eternal life is God's gift to us. Abundant life is our gift to God. And the enemy will do everything he can to stop that abundance from being made manifest in our life through faith, through worship, through giving, through relationships. And that's what we're going to talk about, is the battle is raging on a spiritual level. I wrote down some things last night, and I want you to think about this. John 3:16, your life is of great value. Do you realize that? Your life is of great value. A huge price was paid for you. You were created with a design and an eternal purpose, Jeremiah 29. God knows the plans that he has for you. You were not an accident. Well, Chad, you don't know the circumstances around my birth. I do know that God knew you before you were formed in your womb, and I don't care where it happened. I don't care the circumstances of the conception. You're still purposed to do something wonderful for God. I had a young man come up to me in Brazil one time and tell me about he was a product of rape. And he shared with me his story. And as I automatically wanted to just go and just kind of hug him, he was like, no, I'm telling you this to let you know that, brother, I'm so honored that God... He just went into this whole glorious speech of saying, my past has been redeemed. He said, it's not about the conception, it's about the future I have. And I thought, wow, if I can get a generation to understand that it doesn't matter how you start, it's how you end. You were created male and female. How's that? This is not a politics game, but the Bible says in Genesis 5 that God created him male and female. I was talking to a bunch of teenagers a number of months ago in Tennessee, and somebody said, well, are you sure? I said, look, there's one way to find out if you're male or female. Come on, you work with teenagers, you got to make stupid comments sometimes. I said, go outside, take a look, come back, and everything's good. You shouldn't be saying that in church. Oh my God, just get me started. You are cared for and greatly loved in 1 Peter. You are cared for and greatly loved. Well, Chad, you don't understand my situations. I'm telling you, Jesus says that he loves you and cares for you. You were bought with a huge price, 1 Corinthians. You have a spiritual enemy who hates you and hates the call on your life. Do you realize that the battle rages for you spiritually? Let me get this out the way. Jesus is looking for you to do good to you. That's Acts 10, chapter 38. Chapter 10, verse 38 says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with power, and he went around doing good to everybody. What did he do good to? He did good to the prostitute. He did good to the demon-possessed. He did good to the dead. He did good to the tax collector. In fact, it's amazing that Jesus had his most problems with those who were religious and tried to slam the face of God and slam the door in the face of people who were trying to seek God. So if Jesus wants to do good to you tonight, understand that. The onslaught that comes against you, let's explain some of this that goes on. I began to look at some of the situations that happen as I get approached by teenagers on social media, on email, and even talking through an interpreter overseas. I begin to understand that this battle that rages is taking place now at an even more fervent pitch because of this. This is inert. It's inherently not bad. The technology is not bad. This can do a lot of good things, but I don't have to get into how much evil this can open up to your heart and can open to your mind. Social media. What about the pressures that teenagers deal with on likes, friends, acceptance, popularity? How many likes did I get? Oh, did people see this? Oh, they saw that. Oh, they unfriended me. Oh, they this. Oh, they that. Somebody showed me an app the other day. They said, Chad, you can download this app and it can show you who unfriends you. I said, great. Another reason for me to get depressed. Another reason for me to feel bad about myself. But how many people actually take that thing and go, I got 500 friends. Wait, I just went to 400 and what's going on? I look at my Facebook page the other day, and I just did. I went to it, and I went to the analytics and the metrics, and it said, in the past week, you've had 12 likes. I was like, great. And then I went to last month, 20 dislikes. I said, I must be doing something good if people are disliking me. Because I don't talk about anything but Jesus on my page. You know, you guys are more connected now. We're more connected as a society than we ever have, but we're more alone than we've ever been. People say, oh, this is great. It opens up relationships. It opens up this. No, it doesn't. It takes people and shoves them into a corner. It shoves you into a place to where you're so consumed in this two-dimensional world of thumbs up and smiley faces and bitmojis and this and that. You don't know who's your friend or who's not your friend. Somebody says, well, they're my friend. They really like me. Listen, sister, they don't like you. They like themselves. They want you to just like them so that everybody can say that they're more popular than you. I get tired of seeing all the narcissistic nonsense. It's like somebody taking a picture. It's like, you're so ugly. Quit posting pictures of yourself. What about movies? What about darkness? What about demonic ideas? What about the supernatural realm that we live in? What about Hollywood and the nonsense that they promote every other week? What about going on to any site on Google and type in a couple of keywords and look at the stuff that comes up? For goodness sake, if you pay attention to just what's going on in the Middle East, that's enough to terrify anybody. But yet we spend time looking at that and we think, oh, it's just not going to affect me. The Bible says in Psalms, can a man hold fire against his breast and not be burned by it? Impossible. What about the political campaigns that are going on in the country that are raging now? It undermines the truth of who Jesus is and his ability to help. I think about the political spectrum, and I think about where we've come as a nation. You know, when we took God out of school, that's when suicide went ahead and said, I'll come right on in. If a young person realizes and begins to understand through the indoctrination of some of the things that are going on that maybe God is not real and you came from a monkey and there's no moral accountability, you came from nothing, you go to nothing, just eat, drink, and be merry for tomorrow, you die. There is no hope. And when you go to schools and they tell you all of this nonsense and you go home and it's not confirmed or, opposed by your parents, what do? You begin to believe the lie. Bit by bit, step by step, we have a systematic plan of attack against a generation. Now, all of this can translate into a real spirit of hopelessness with young people. And this is what I would call to be the spirit of the age. I was in Brazil when my phone began to explode a couple of weeks ago about some of the tragedy that happened here in San Bernardino and in Redlands. And it was interesting because I was in Brazil doing life events, events like this for teenagers. And I thought, this is not something that's relegated to culture. It's not something that's isolated to an American thing. This is a global issue. But it was real personal when it came home. In fact, Richard, when you began to text me, and then Dan was texting, and Luke, we're going back and forth, and I thought, my God, this is something that we're not paying attention to. This is something that's insidious, that's creeping in, and is hijacking a generation. And I told God, I said, look, I'm willing to run my mouth about it. I have a lot to say, God. I said, but at the end of the day, I realize that it's not by might and it's not by power, but it's by the Spirit of God that we break strongholds in the lives of people. Now, let's look at the God of this world for a minute. Let's look at Lucifer. Let's look at the system that he has control of. Jesus says that the prince of the world controls the entire system. He does. He controls it. He controls the media. And if he can get you discouraged, and the way he does that is with the suicide thing, I started thinking about the survivors of suicide. Who are the victims of suicide? The survivors. The parents, the friends, the classmates, the nieces, the nephews, the grandparents. We're the ones who are left to pick up the pieces after all of this takes place. But when that begins to happen, we begin to get discouraged because we think, wait a minute, man, I've just lost a friend. I've lost a spouse. I've lost this. I've lost that. Do you understand that suicide doesn't just affect the person who then takes their life, but it affects those of us who are left to pick up the pieces and answer all the questions? And sometimes that can be an incredibly dangerous place for a group of young people who lose a peer to something so tragic. And the enemy will capitalize on that and say, see, you're not safe either. I'm coming after you next. And these are things that really get told to young people in their ear, communicated to them spiritually. Isaiah 7:9 says this, if you don't stand for your faith, you'll fall for anything. How many times have I encouraged young people, pastors, leaders, parents around the planet, and said, if you can just encourage your young person, your child, to stand for one thing in faith, Jesus is Lord. Just one thing, if you can build a foundation, a pedestal of one thing, I said it will keep them from falling for the nonsense that comes against them every day. Let's go on. Suicide has varied components, and I've looked at this. You've got the medical component, you've got the social component, you have a number of things. Like I said, I am not a doctor. I want to talk about the spiritual component. I feel like that's what God's called me to do. The Bible says in Ephesians 6 that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Most people don't ever like to look at life like this, but I remember there was a movie that came out years ago with Rowdy Roddy Piper. Anybody remember that movie? Come on, some of the older guys in here. It was called Them or They. One of the things, this guy had a pair of glasses, and he'd put them on, and he would see that there was just aliens everywhere. And I thought, God, that'd be a great pair of glasses to have. Can you imagine selling that after church? Bro, we could make some money. But I started thinking, you know what? When you come into relationship with God, there is something that happens to the way you see things. And you understand that it's not just cut and dry. It's not just black and white. There's a gray realm that we are involved in that we can't see, but yet exerts incredible influence on us. It affects the way we think. It affects our emotions. And you combine that with media, with television, with everything that's going on, it can be a deadly combination. It's a spiritual battle. Now, the real demons, real forces are designed to stop you. They hate your call. Do you realize that you have a call on your life? Each one of you in here, I believe from the front, side, back, everybody here is called to do something for God. And do you understand that the assignment against you is to not only destroy you, but to destroy who's been assigned to you? My friend Perry Stone preached a message one time and he broke it down to scripture and he says that he believes every person has at least seven people attached to them for salvation. That each person has at least seven people that are designed to have your life impact them. And if you do the math, that's an incredible exponential growth. He's trying to stop the call of God on your life. What about curses on your family tree? What about people in here who struggle with things? Joel, once again, you and I can go on this, dealing with breaking free, dealing with deliverance. Is it people who have a curse on their family tree, the Bible says, even to the fourth generation? You say, well, why am I an alcoholic? Because your dad was, because your grandfather was. Well, that doesn't make any sense to me. Understand it's a spiritual principle that's here. Things get attached to us, luggage, it follows us around. I have friends of mine who have struggled with alcoholism for years. And as we begin to talk about some of this, they said, you know, it's amazing. I just had the realization that this is something that's on my family line. This is something that's following me. And what made them become aware that there was a problem because they now had teenagers who were starting to fool around with alcohol. And he said, I've got to stop this. And I said, let's pray and let's break that. Have it stop now in the name of Jesus. So here we have a generational curse. What about people who say, well, I was just born this way. Chad, you don't understand. This is just the way I was born. I was born this way. This is why I tell people, get born again. That's the solution to every big problem that comes up. Well, Chad, I was just born like this. I'm just supposed to be like my dad. I'm supposed to be like this. I was born in poverty. I'm just going to live out the rest of my life in poverty. Listen, Jesus said, you don't have to live like that. This is why he said, be born again. Well, Chad, I was just born this way. I'm attracted to this and attracted to that. Listen, that's your right. That's exactly how you were born. You're born with a weakness. You're born with a limp. I get it. But that still doesn't change the fact that Jesus says, if you really want change, you must be born again. How many young people have I seen over the years born into a particular orientation and have an encounter with Jesus and say, my God, somebody was lying to me. Let's go on. Satan will use the weakness in the lives of other people and direct his attack to that point. Satan will look at the weakness in your life and direct the attack against you. What about abuse? How many young people have I talked to who have been sexually abused? And that is the exact angle that Satan uses to come in and begin to belittle them. You see, we're all born with inherent weaknesses. We all have things about us that are flaws. Some are visible, some are invisible. And Satan, because he is such a sneaky piece of garbage, he always wants to prey on the weakest one in the bunch. And he'll look at you and say, let me push that button, let me push that button, let me go after that. And that's what gets us going. There are certain factors that kind of stimulate us to begin to really think, wait a minute, there's something wrong. What about rejection? How many young people do I talk to all over the world who experience rejection because of friends, social media, girlfriends, boyfriends? How about parents who reject their children? You're stupid, you're no good, you're not going to amount to anything. Just the words, the rejection that comes up. Satan takes that and does what? Exploits it in our lives. Insecurity. You're not rich enough. You're not smart enough. You'll never be any good. You see, the spirit of the age is always looking to do what? Keep you down and discourage you. What about body issues? Well, I'm too fat. I'm not athletic enough. I'm not good looking enough. And I hear this all the time. Especially young women in today's society to where you have to look like you stepped off of a billboard to feel like you have any self-worth. That's just not even the truth. But yet the enemy will play on that and begin to remind you every day that you're not good enough, that you don't look good enough, you're not talented enough, you're not this, you're not that. What about financial pressures? What about trying to keep up with the Joneses? I met three girls in Thailand 5 years ago at a meeting, and they came up to me and they were real embarrassed and they wanted to talk, and I have the translator. It was very, very funny. But it wasn't funny when they told me what they did. I said, how do you have an iPhone? They were prostituting on the side. These are just normal, beautiful, little cute girls. I said, how do you get the money to do what you do? And they were just hooking on the side thinking it was no big deal. The financial pressure of trying to keep up with your friends. What about the Kardashian syndrome? Do you know when I go overseas, I apologize for Southern California on behalf of that trash every time I get in the pulpit. I said, don't judge us by what you see on TV. So with all of these weaknesses, what does that translate into for us? Here's what it translates into. In Luke 15, what did Jesus say? Is that when the shepherd has a group of 99 sheep or 100 sheep, what is the plan and strategy of the enemy? To take that one sheep, pull him out of the group, and stick him in the corner. Because if he can get you by yourself, if he can get you listening to only his voice and not the voice of the shepherd, you're going to get confused and you're going to get devoured. That's the plan of the enemy. That was Napoleon's plan, divide and conquer. That's how he conquered most of the world that he was involved in. Because he's able to separate and to split and to divide. Then he would go after the weakest one. Just watch the Discovery Channel. The hyenas always go after the little ones, don't they? The two biggest pillars that I found in the suicide mindset, and I've seen this and heard this firsthand, is unforgiveness and shame. Unforgiveness definition is a grudge against someone who has offended you, or you do not have the compassion to forgive. Shame is a feeling of guilt, regret, embarrassment, or sadness that you feel because you know you've done something wrong. Shame. It's one of the number one forces coming against a generation globally. Because of what you see on social media, how many teenagers have I spoken to who've come up to me just addicted to porn because of this thing right here? They don't want to tell anybody. It drives them into a corner. They quit going to church. They quit talking to their parents. And they live a life of just complete isolation because of just one bad decision. And the enemy bros on, gives them shame and says, nobody will ever love you. Nobody will ever experience anything good about you. All they're going to see is your mistakes. That's what shame does to you. Let me explain this a little bit further. You understand that this is something that is a supernatural deal we're fighting. I was just in Brazil 3 weeks ago. We had an incredible meeting at a Baptist church. Come on, it's good to have the Holy Ghost show up in a Baptist church. It's funny because when they ask me to come, they say, oh, Shaggy. That's how my name is pronounced in Portuguese because it's a D and a D is a G. They say, oh, Shaggy, why don't you come and preach? And I'm like, great. And they see the show and some of the other stuff. And I go in there and they have no idea. And at the altar call, a girl came up to me. She was beautiful, 17 years old. And she looked like what you would think of a typical, beautiful Brazilian girl. Came up afterwards. And she had a young lady standing with her. And through my translator, I said, what's the deal? What's going on? She'd been abused by her father and her cousin for years, sexually. She sat there just weeping, wouldn't even look me in the eye. I was getting part of the conversation through the other translator that was there. And she wanted to give her life to Jesus, but there was so much shame, which then forced her into that place of unforgiveness to where she says, I just don't trust Jesus. He's a man. Isn't that... And I said, look at me. I said, you're going to have to set your heart to forgive. And I said, and when you do, that's when everything's going to change. She was terrified. She says, how can God ever accept me because of what has happened to me? I said, sweetheart, this wasn't your fault. I said, you didn't do anything except be born beautiful. I said, you were taken advantage of. As we began to talk to her and minister to her, I thought, you know what? That's what the enemy wants to do. If he can bring the shame to such a degree, it then gets to a place where they're like, I am so embarrassed. I could never go to the one who could forgive me because I'm too shamed. You see, it's just a game. It's like a dice game. He just brings you to the place and then just pulls you back in. She wanted forgiveness, but every time she would reach out for it, she would begin to get shamed back into the corner. And I looked in that look in those eyes and I said, look at me. And as we began to pray, the Holy Ghost just dropped on that girl and she began to weep uncontrollably. I said, pray this prayer with me. That was the first step in her seeing a complete recovery. Do you understand that? She set her heart to forgive those who had done wrong to her. She looked shame in the face and said, Jesus, I trust you. Help me. That's when everything changed. When you labor with shame and unforgiveness, you have difficulty forgiving others. You have difficulty forgiving those who've rejected you. You have difficulty forgiving those who've abused you. You have difficulty even understanding your sexuality when things have been confused and taken advantage of. You've been called names, you've been bullied, you've been made fun of. And that shoves you into a corner. And that shame will tell you, don't you dare look up and don't you dare look for help, because nobody will ever help you. We have difficulty forgiving ourselves, and the enemy knows that, and that's a weakness he goes after. And for the young people that I've talked to who've attempted suicide, they always bring up the point, they said, how could I ever forgive myself for causing so much pain to my family? I felt that suicide was the only way out. Abortion. The shame that goes with that forces a young woman into a place to where she'll never trust again. What about your addictions? Joel, what about the addictions that we deal with people every day? And that addiction does what? Tells them you're not worth anything. Your life is pointless. You're never going to be free. You're never going to have a chance. Sit in the corner and be quiet. What about the words that you've spoken that are embarrassment to you? Maybe you can't forgive yourself for the words you've spoken that you've hurt people. Husbands have said things to wives. Wives have said things to husbands. What about the thoughts that you have? It's hard to forgive yourself at times when you think the things you think. Because of all of this, I find a generation is experts at building walls. Experts at building walls. In fact, I'll never forget when I traveled to India the first time back in the 1980s. Gee, that's an old time ago. I was amazed that these compounds had these brick walls that were built as high as the roof of the house. And inside of, on top of the walls, it was all filled with plaster and glass and nails and spikes and barbed wire. And I thought, man, nobody's climbing in that place. And then I thought, and nobody's climbing out either. You see, the walls that a generation builds for protection, if not dealt with and not attacked from a spiritual perspective, become the prison cells that ultimately trap you. The walls we build become our prisons when we don't address these issues in our life, especially as it pertains to faith and what Jesus wants to do. I read an article in Brazil. It was in English, of course. My Portuguese is terrible. And it said 60 to 80% of all people who live rarely ever fulfill the call of God on their life. The numbers were varied, and I appreciate the text and some of the stuff. But I began to look. When I was in South Africa, I went to one of the oldest cemeteries in Cape Town. And as I looked over the headstones of black, white, colored, Zulu, Dutch, you name it, I thought, this is the greatest resource in this entire nation. There is more potential in the ground that's finished now. Books unwritten, words unspoken, dreams unfulfilled, all in the ground. People who died never doing what God called them to do, never reaching out in faith. And I thought, there's so much potential there, but now it's gone. Let me close on this and we'll go. Hopelessness and despair is something that comes up all the time. Hopelessness says this. This is what CNN and Fox News says. Hello? Turn on the news and what do you see? Economy's bad. Environment's falling apart. Global warming. Whatever. It was raining and cold yesterday in San Bernardino. I don't know which global warming when it wasn't here. ISIS is coming. Terror, gonna take your guns. Nobody's saying anything positive on television. Have you ever noticed that? Sometimes I turn on the news and I'm like, I can't watch this anymore because I just want to scream. It manipulates your emotions that says, no hope, you have no future, things will never change. Status quo. You're just a gerbil on a treadmill. Nothing's ever gonna change for you. It tells you that God's mad at you. You ever hear that? God's mad at you. People hear that all the time. God's mad at me. Really? Who told you that? Who told you God was mad at you? I don't know. I just think that. Well, you're wrong. He's not. He got mad 2,000 years ago and settled the issue with his son. Hopelessness tells you that your marriages are going to fail. Hopelessness tells you you'll never have a job that goes above minimum wage. Hopelessness, the spirit of the age tells you, why not quit because you're not going to win anyway. Discouragement, discouragement everywhere you look. It's always bad news. There's never any good news. Never. I like what Joyce Meyer says about words. Words are containers for power. What about the words that are being spoken over your life? What about the words your friends say to you? What about the words your boyfriend and girlfriend say to you? What about the words your parents say to you? What about the words your spouse speaks over you? Do you understand those words can determine your future? And even though they're small, they have great power and great weight. Proverbs 29 says, where there is no vision, the people perish. Understand that when you have God's vision, God speaks life, the system speaks death. We look to the wrong sources for encouragement all the time. If you want encouragement, come and be involved in the youth group. Come to a meeting like this. Come and be involved with people who love you and see the real value of who you are instead of people who would... It's better to be celebrated than tolerated. Come to a place to where you're celebrated. Spend time with people who celebrate your uniqueness. Come spend time with people who like, Chad, you got a big snake in your house. That's awesome. Not the people who go, man, that must be of the devil. Come on, man. I tolerate people like that. Give me a break. Let me close with this because I want to get in. I want to show you a video clip. But let me just, there are five cultural things that we have seen concerning suicide. And they've been the same in every culture. Same in Brazil, same in China, same in India, same in South America, and same in the U.S. And I want to give them to you right now. Same in Japan. These are the five cultural similarities with suicide. Top five contributing factors found to be true in young people who are struggling with suicide. Older people, anyone who's struggling. Number one, a lack of self-worth. A lack of self-worth. What are you hearing and what are you seeing? Who's speaking into your life? Do you find value in who you are? Number two, lack of community. No church, no religious affiliation, and no social life outside of this dumb thing. My wife has a thing in the house. It's a little board that says, go outside and play. Social life, go out. When I was a kid, it was fun to go out and catch alligators and snakes. Nowadays, you don't have to. You can just watch somebody else do it on your phone. It's not the same, guys. Trust me, I've got scars to prove it. It is not the same. No support structure, lack of community, no support structure, nobody to help you. Number three, breakdown of family. Divorce. Adultery. It destroys the life of a young person. Do you understand that? One of the biggest issues that we have to deal with when we do certain altar calls in Brazil is young people who are coming from broken homes and the father's just no longer there. They have no concept of a father's love. They understand that a dad gives you what you need, but a father gives you what you want. Father gives you what you want, dad gives you what you need. And they're confused. They said, well, if God, how come God won't let me do this? My dad lets me do this. I said, because God wants to be your father, not your dad. Paul said, you have not many fathers. We need more people to father a generation. Number four, isolation and loneliness. Social media. Even God said it's not good that man is alone. Isolation and loneliness pushes you into a corner and says, you know what? Things are never going to change. I'm all by myself. How many people in this church right now are lonely? Not alone. Lonely. Sometimes being alone is good, but being lonely is never good. And in a community like this, let me tell you what, you have no excuse to be lonely. You have no excuse to feel like that nobody cares about you because there's people who do care about you. And the fifth one, no communication. Nobody ever talks about the problems that's going on, especially with young people. They don't want to talk about it. Parents don't want to talk about it. Counselors are uncomfortable talking about it, especially as it pertains to suicide, because they're like, what do I say to this person? And the young person's like, well, what are they going to think of me? Lack of communication. People are scared to talk about the subject. We have to talk about it. That's why we're here tonight. Once again, if you have a child, I'd like for you to go ahead. If the child's under 12, I ask that you please move them out. The video we're about to see is graphic. Let me explain this to you. Is it anybody has paid attention to some of the latest Hollywood releases? There's one called The Forest. It came out. This was about the Aokigahara. This was about the Sea of Trees. This is about the place in Japan that's located at the base of Mount Fuji. It's the number one place for people to take their life in the world. This was all, and I think Luke, you and Dan and Richard probably remember this. Many years ago, we had a person who was involved with one of our staff, and he had a friend who took their life. I had a close friend of mine's daughter kill herself. And then Dr. Barron had a friend of his who attempted suicide, and we said, that's enough. We've got to do something to address this. And I was intimidated because I thought, you know what, how in the world can I address this? I'm not a doctor, I'm not a psychologist, I'm just a voice of anybody else. And God said, just use what's in your hand, Chad. I said, great, God, I have a Sony camera, I'm going to Japan. So my senior producer, Paul and Dr. Barron, they found a place, they found the Sea of Trees. We said, let's go there. We were all intimidated because what do? You just show up at a place. We went to create a documentary. And Japan's a hot spot for suicide, guys. You know what a kamikaze is, pilot. You know what the samurai are. You know what all of these words are. It's ingrained in culture. It's accepted in Japan, but it's really not talked about very much, and it should be. And so as we begin to interview young people, I talk to countless young people, Christian and non-Christian, why suicide in Japan? Why is it an issue? You know what they told me? The same 5 points I just brought up, that's what they told me. Line by line, they brought up again the lack of community, isolation and loneliness, no communication, lack of self-worth. And I thought, my gosh, there's something going on here that we need to address. When we were there, I found out about a book called The Complete Manual of Suicide. I found it in Ginza Square at like a Noble's bookstore. It's a book, it's only in Japanese. It tells you how to kill yourself. It tells you how to do it. It tells you on a scale from 1 to 10, if it's painful, if it's not. And it, to no surprise, tells you the perfect place to die is in the Sea of Trees in Japan. And I thought, you know what? Let's go take this on. And so what you're about to see is a clip. And I use this clip. This is in now in 5 languages. And when I go do events around the world, I show this portion of the clip in the language. And without fail, every time, the video does exactly what it was created to do. And so I want to share that with you. That's part of the life event structure that I do. I wanted to bring some information. I feel like I needed to talk about some of these things, but I'm going to let the video finish what I started. And so once again, if you have a child and they're under 12, you want to leave, the video is 12 minutes long. It's fast-paced. It is graphic. This was not set up. All of this happened live on camera, and it's still amazing to me when I see it, what God did with this clip. So I want to introduce the Sea of Trees to you for the next couple of minutes. One of the weird things about Japan is that there's manuals for everything that explain how to do thus and such, but I think one of the most damning manuals found in Japan is called the Complete Manual of Suicide. And one of the reasons the Sea of Trees has come up, based on Mount Fuji,
because this book describes that it's actually the perfect place to die. Here it is. This is it. This is the complete manual of suicide. I mean, this is the premier book here in Japan that explains how to kill yourself. And this is why the phenomenon of the Sea of Trees has grown to such great heights, because this book has planted seeds in the heart of young and old alike that the Sea of Trees is the place to go to hang yourself, to poison yourself. It's what's called a perfect place to die, if there is such a thing, and this book explains how to do it. It's only in Japanese, and you can only find it over here. And so it's amazing that something this small, something this innocuous, could in fact infect thousands of people, planting that seed in their mind that suicide's not only good, but there's an actual perfect way to die. Unbelievable. Behind me is Mount Fuji, Japan's largest active volcano. To my left and to my right is the Sea of Trees. This area has been popular with tourists for hundreds of years, but until recently, this pristine environment has been marred. The Sea of Trees has been known as the perfect place to die. People from Japan and from other parts of the world come here to tragically end their lives.
Well, from here, what it's telling you is, you know, just the general idea of where the idea of Jukai and why people start killing themselves there. So the history of it and how you get inside and the different landmark points that you can look at in order for you to get to the place where you can kill yourself and not be found.
So really, these are three places to where you could go in. And they're trying to say the main point of this is to go in, do it, and then nobody will be able to find your body.
Exactly. Okay, so there's a bus stop called Momiji-dai entrance. It says if you keep going on the road for 1 kilometer, it's gonna come to a point where it's just trees. So if you go 100 meters, just 100 meters, even though you try to remember where you came from, you won't remember. And then eventually you will be eternally forgotten by others.
This is an alien environment. The lava that's been shoved up over thousands of years, the displacement of water, have caused all these pockets and holes and caves that fall through. As you can see, every tree here has its roots dug into this massive infrastructure. The moss has a place to grow. You've got lichens. You've got homes for every kind of creature. It is beautiful. I'll give you that. It's one of the most beautiful environments I've ever seen. Like take for example this cave. Now there are these pockets, these recesses that go way beyond what you can see. Home for rabbits, spiders, lizards. There have been reports of people actually climbing into these cave areas and pulling rocks on themselves to bury themselves alive in structures like this. The concept of suicide can be difficult for anybody to talk about, but what makes it even more disturbing is that most of the suicides that do take place in this forest are based on this book. It goes so far that those who have been found have a copy of the book at their feet or on their person. In fact, if you go to the section to where it talks about how to end your life in this area, the recommended way to do it is by asphyxiation or by hanging. In fact, all throughout the forest, if you were to really take your time, you could find human remains that are here. If someone were to continue to fool around with books like the Suicide Manual, continue to involve themselves in elements of life that promote death, that promote depression, that feed that idea that you have to be alone and you have to take your life into your own hands, the end result is always going to be the same. Books like this are a fluke as far as I'm concerned. But the enemy uses books like this, the novelty of them, to prey upon those who have no relationship with God and to begin to sow those seeds of death into them. The ultimate culmination of that seed being brought back to life is death. This forest is a testament to the power of words in people's life. The answers that you're looking for are not found in a moment of knee-jerk decision and reaction. They're found in making a methodical choice to follow life, regardless of how far it seems to take you. Now, what you're seeing is not a setup. This is not a Hollywood prop. This is not something I paid for in the U.S. As we came into the forest and made our way to find a location, I began to smell something. It's familiar to me. I mean, I knew what it was, but never in my wildest dreams did I think that less than half a mile off the main road, I would come on something like this. The condition of the body shows one that's been here for a number of months. The elements have taken their toll. Most of the soft tissue is gone. The ligaments and the muscles are now holding the bones together. There's not even flies on this thing. It's like a mummy. And to find this in this place, it's a bit unnerving. We didn't come here to rejoice in someone's death. We didn't come here to see anything. The whole issue is that this is a very real problem. Not just here in Japan, but around the world. And I don't even know what this guy's name is. I can't do anything for him now. I can't. And anything that I would do would totally be out of respect for burying the body. I mean, this is a scene that's unbelievable. Imagine coming into a place like this, knowing that this was your final resting spot. You've already made all your plans. You've already made all your preparations. You've said all of your goodbyes. I mean, what must your mind be thinking? I mean, your heart has got to be just racing, about to burst out of your chest. Your mind is flooded. Your emotions are a mess. And you know that this is where your life ends. It's a horrible place to be. Especially a place like this, to where it's said that your body will never, ever be found. Even though you may be considering suicide, in the back of your mind, you do want to be found. Maybe you're doing this out of vengeance. Maybe you're doing this to get back at somebody. Maybe this is your last grand stage entrance in a life that has somehow been incredibly unfair to you. Maybe this is the way you're going to get back at everybody. You know, it's a very selfish way to think. Because when you find yourself here, all alone, it's just you, your mind, your soul, and your God. You're going to have to face Him. You're going to have to give an explanation as to why you chose to give up the greatest gift that you've ever been given. And that's life. And you can make all the excuses you want. You can say, well, nobody ever told me. You have been told. Well, I just didn't feel like it. You know what? It's not about the way you feel. It's about faith. It's about what you know to be true. Well, I was raised this religion. I was raised that religion. It doesn't matter about religion. Religion's never the answer. It's always a relationship with God. There has to be a place to where you humble yourself and you understand that what you're about to do cannot be rewound as on a tape player. You can't just push restart and it'll just come back. This is an eternal act. This is a final, ultimate decision that you have thought about and premeditated. Let me tell you what else you may not have considered is you haven't planned this on your own. No way. You've had a greater force at play at this. Those thoughts that have been tormenting you, they're not your own. Those emotions that just seem to come on you like a wet blanket, those aren't your own either. You've got to open your eyes and realize that we are in a war. You're in a war and you're the prize. You are the prize for this war. One side is battling for you. The other is battling for you. But as you allow yourself to give in to that negative deception, to give in to that fear, to give in to those lies, to give in to the system that so wants to crush you like dust, what you're saying to the side which gave everything for you is, I'm a hopeless case. My life is too far gone. It's too messed up. You don't know what I've done. You don't know what's gone through my head. Do you know if you knew, if you could see what I thought, you'd never, ever accept me. You know what I want to do is I want that lie to be exposed in the name of Jesus. Every one of those spirits that's lying to you, I command it to let go of your mind. You need to open your ears right now. You need to open your heart and listen, because this isn't me speaking to you. This is God speaking to you. I'm just a man, but the message here is prying into that darkened thing that you call a heart. You know why? Because God's not given up on you. You may have given up on yourself. Friends and family may have given up on you, but heaven is never going to give up on you. It'll keep badgering you and loving you and pulling you and encouraging you. And when you fall down, it'll keep pulling you back up. So in the name of Jesus, I speak life over you. I speak life that darkness would flee, that the power of God, that's right, the power of God would fill your heart right now, and that the spirit of death would leave. And I speak life over you. If God can speak life into me, He can most assuredly speak life into you. None of us deserve what God has to offer. None of us deserve what God came to give, but He came to give it anyway. And that those who would believe even that much, the faith of a mustard seed can change your entire future. The sea of trees, a place where people come to die. But the way I see it, is an incredible place to live. As the sun comes down on the sea of trees, I'm leaving. What about your life? The sun is going down. If you've even remotely considered suicide as an option, you need to turn and walk toward the light and get out of this place, because the longer you stay here, the longer you acknowledge that you're not worth anything and that no one can ever help you.
Tough video. It's a tough video to watch. It's a tough video even now for me to watch. 20 years ago last month, I got a knock on the door from a police officer I'd never seen. And he told me my father was found dead. We didn't know the circumstances. I got on a plane and traveled to where he lived, went into the apartment and found the suicide note. And I told God, I said, if you can take this tragedy and work it for good, I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do. And I look at a generation around the world. I see them on Facebook. I see them face to face. I hear their stories of pain. I hear their stories of rejection. And it moves me to such a place to where I feel compelled to aggressively communicate how loved you are and how incredibly important you are in the plan of God. And that what you may be struggling with now is designed to do one thing, and that's stop the life that's been given as a gift to you. Regardless of what thought may be going through your head, regardless of the emotions that are raging there, understand is that suicide is not an option. Not a viable one. Not one that can ever bring you into that place of abundant life that Jesus said we can have if we choose to reside in Him. I want to ask a couple of questions. Most of the time I speak to teenagers. It's unusual that I have adults in a service. It just is. It's good, but it's not my normal thing. So I realize there's a lot of people here tonight in a lot of different categories, and I know a lot of people are hiding. Whenever you begin to talk about suicide, in fact, I talked to a doctor just last week, and he said one of the reasons that society and media and news organizations don't like to talk about the suicide rates because they're afraid of copycats. They're afraid of it becoming something bigger and morphing. I think about my friends who are veterans. You know, 22 veterans kill themselves every day. You know, I know there are people here who are battling for their life, battling with thoughts of suicide, darkness. Maybe you have attempted suicide and you failed. Maybe you've actually considered suicide. Maybe you came in here tonight and you're the person I was talking to in the video and you have your plans. Maybe that thought is becoming something that you're really grabbing a hold of. Maybe you've thought about it. Now maybe you're talking about it. My concern is the third point, is that you may actually try it. Let me tell you what. Is that Jesus said he's come to give us life. And that where you are tonight in that place of darkness, walled in that corner, stuck in that place of isolation, thinking that no one cares, let me tell you tonight, you are greatly loved and greatly cared for. And you don't have to leave this place tonight laboring under those thoughts and laboring under that oppression. Maybe you've been affected by suicide. Maybe you've lost a friend. Maybe you've lost a family member. Maybe you've lost a father, maybe a mother. Maybe it has so impacted you that maybe the grieving has just gone way beyond the normal process. Or maybe you're afraid and you say, you know what, Chad, this is on my family line and I want this thing broken off of my life. One of the greatest concerns for me was that suicide that was on my family's tree. A number of years ago, I got a phone call from my sister. And she just sobbed and heaved on the phone and said, pray for me. I said, why? She goes, I want to kill myself. I just got angry. I said, in the name of Jesus, take the telephone and put it on your chest right now. And I just began to pray in the name of Jesus. She screamed and dropped that phone. An hour later, she called me back. She goes, my God, what happened to me? I said, I know what happened to you. Jesus showed up in your house. She goes, something's different. I said, exactly. I said, only he can make all things new. See, the Bible says the blood of Jesus speaks better things than the blood of your family. Maybe you've stopped fighting for your life, young people. Maybe you're so discouraged and so distraught. Maybe you're dealing with an oppression. Maybe you're dealing with a supernatural attack that is making you want to quit up, not just on the physical side, but maybe you're giving up spiritually. It's too hard to be a Christian. I can't do this. You're just willing to throw in the towel. Let me tell you what, that's an attack that's coming against you. This is the book. It's found on almost everybody. Everybody that's found in the Sea of Trees has this book either on its person or beside them on the ground. This book tells you how to die. Tells you where to go, tells you how to do it, gives you every little detail you could ever imagine. This book tells you how to end your life. This book is found in the heart of every believer. This book communicates life. This book tells you how to live. This book gives you details on how to have success and live in abundance. This book says that you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. Here's what I want to do tonight with everybody looking at me. I'm speaking to young and old all over the place. San Bernardino has been rocked in the past 6 months with many issues, and they all revolve around death. And there is no way I'm going to live in this city and be involved with a church like this and have friends and pastors like this and men of God we work alongside and just let that thing creep in and say, you know what? We're just going to... No. I say in the name of Jesus, enough is enough. And I understand. understand that the most vulnerable of us, the ones at most risk, are the ones that we call our very own. Can you feel the Spirit of God? I can. And whenever he begins to manifest himself, he comes to do one thing, and that's to do good to those who feel like nothing good will ever happen again. If you're in this place tonight, and listen, I know this can be interesting. You say, oh, I don't want anybody to know. Listen, that's the problem. If the enemy keeps you in a corner, nobody knows, how can you get help? If he can keep you silent, if he can keep you walled off by yourself, then who can help you? So Jesus said, he says he left the 99 and went after the one. If you're in here tonight, young or old, and you've been battling with thoughts of suicide, maybe you've experienced some oppression that is supernaturally dark and you don't understand where it's coming from. Maybe there's something on your bloodline that we can break in the name of Jesus. Maybe you are a survivor of suicide. Maybe you've attempted and maybe you live in so much shame. Tonight, you know what? That weakness and that issue in your life can become a platform of strength to where you can become a voice to those who are thinking about it, and you can share that there is life beyond the thought of suicide. If you're in here and you know God is dealing with you right now and you say, Chad, I want freedom. I want you to pray with me. And I want my life to be different. Maybe you're a family and you're dealing with a young person who is struggling with those thoughts. Maybe you are confused yourself, wondering, why is this happening to my family? Let me tell you what, this is why The Rock is here, because we love families. We love your children. We love you. We want to rally around you and see that thing broken and see that you have what? Abundant life that Jesus said you could have. This is why we have an altar here, and this is why there's such an emphasis at The Rock on an altar call. Because even when Abraham would walk through the Old Testament scriptures, when he had an encounter with God, he built an altar. She agrees with me. Don't y'all agree? Without an altar, a man can't have change. So here's what I want to do. If you're in here and you say, Chad, I want prayer, I want you to stand to your feet. Young and old, whoever you are, takes courage to stand. Thank you. Thank you. Takes courage to stand. If you're in here and you've considered suicide, I'm speaking to you. If that thought has crossed your mind and it's something that continually comes up, I want you to understand that there's a seed, an attack that's coming against you. We want to break that off of you tonight. If you're standing to your feet, I want you to do one more thing. Come down here to the altar with me so we can pray. Let your faith produce muscle movement. I want you to come down here. Isn't it good to know that Jesus wants to do good to you? Come on, there's a real spirit of freedom in here. I want you just to press in, guys. Come on. If there is a problem with lack of community, it's not going to be lack of community in the Rock Church. We're not going to say that you're not worth it. You're worth every time that we get in this place. You're worth every second. You're worth everything that we invest in, because it's about you. The church is not a building. The church is familia. It's community. It's people who have a need, and we rally around them to love them, to support them, and encourage them. One more thing I want to ask, is feel led to ask this. If you're in here and you've lost somebody to suicide, sometimes the guilt, the shame can be overwhelming. And I understand. But there has to be a place to where we say, Jesus, I'm giving it to you. I'm going to live the rest of my life in joy, understanding that you control everything. If you're a parent, if you're a grandparent, if you're somebody who's lost somebody to suicide and you're really struggling on a whole nother odd level of real grief and confusion, I want to pray with you. If that's you, I want you to just make your way forward, but we're going to go ahead and pray right now. I want you to put your hands in the air. Everybody standing here. Come on, this is just an act of faith. Come on, we're rallying around in faith. Come on, begin to sing that. Worthy is the Lamb. Is the Lamb. You. Come on, begin to lift your voices in worship. Holy. Come on, lift your voices. Come on, as you lift that voice to Jesus. Come on, heaven begins to move. Worthy is the Lamb.
You are
holy.
Are you, Lord God?
Come on, worship God.
Almighty.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
I'm going to pray over you. And I'm going to pray a mass prayer of breaking off of everyone who's standing here. In fact, off of everybody who's in this building. That in the name of Jesus, every lie that's been spoken is going to be shut down in the name of Jesus. Every spirit that's attacking you in the name of Jesus, it has to go. And every curse on your bloodline must bow its knee to the name of Jesus. Church family, I want you to stretch your hands toward these who are standing here. The Bible says when we agree in His name, when we do the greatest thing that we can do for another, and that's lift our voices to heaven on their behalf, let me tell you what, heaven begins to move. Father, in the name of Jesus, over every person here, I say that the blood of Jesus speaks greater things over you. Spirit of suicide and death, I command you to leave this place now in the name of Jesus. We break every curse and declare that Jesus is greater, that His word is greater, that His power is greater. Every addiction that would force you in the corner, I command it to break in the name of Jesus. Every thought, every idea, every dark place in the name of Jesus, I speak life into that right now. The life and light of God. God, we declare life over every person standing here. We declare that You will live and that Your abundant life will bring glory to God. And that the words of Jesus speak much greater things than the words of those who've spoken over you. I say in Jesus' name, freedom reigns in this house. And we declare corporately that in San Bernardino, we say that life has a place and a foundation here, and we agree that it's going to begin to grow. We speak to the north, south, east, and west and say, San Bernardino, you will live. San Bernardino, you will prosper. San Bernardino, you will see the glory of God. San Bernardino, the Inland Empire will come to know Jesus. Lack of community, lack of communication. Let me tell you what, if you're in this church tonight and you don't have a church home, I invite you to be involved with a bunch of crazy people who want to tell you the truth. I invite you to be involved with a group of people who want to love you, get dirty with you, smell bad with you, and help you. Because you know what heaven's hearing nowadays? You know what heaven's voice is tuned to? Dirty, ugly, uncomfortable prayers. And that's what we hear in church all the time. Heaven responds to those broken prayers, those needs, as we begin to communicate how much we need Him. It gets uncomfortable at times. Let me tell you what, that's when you see the glory of God. That's when you see the glory of God. Grab the hand of somebody next to you. If you're a young person in here, quickly, I want you to look at me. I believe the scale of the attack that we are seeing in this generation is equal to the call that's there. That the reason we are seeing such an increase and such a demonic assault against a generation, because this is a generation that's going to usher in the return of Christ. This is a generation that I believe God is going to use in signs and wonders, that we're going to take over the school, that we're going to see people set free, we're going to see communities change, and I'm telling you what, a child shall lead them. I believe God's raising up an army of young people. And so when I see the attack come against my children, come against your children, come against children all over the world, I'm like, oh Jesus, give us the grace to stand and believe that you are going to make all things new, and that your grace is more than enough to see a generation rise in great power and great authority and see Jesus glorified in every arena of life. Don't let the devil stop what God's called you to. Don't let him. The greatest piece of advice I've ever given any young person in any of the meetings around the world is this: when you fall down, get back up. Don't just lay there. Get back up. I told the FCA today at Rev, I said, this is why Jesus sent the disciples out two by two, because when one falls down, the other one is there to help them up and to love them and to encourage them. This is community. This is family. This is church. Listen, we have resources in the community that are available. If you're struggling in a mental health issue, there's doctors out there who want to help you. There's resources available. There's counseling. There is a whole side that can really do some wonderful things. But there's also the spiritual side. Don't forget, you're a three-part being. Don't forget the spiritual side. Whom Jesus sets free is free indeed. Amen. Luke, why don't you come on and just pray over us.
We're going to just pronounce a blessing over this church, over this city, over this valley. Afterwards, what we're going to do is Chad and some of the pastors here at the church, our youth leaders are here, some of our prayer leaders are at the church, our church leaders, they're going to come, and if you came forward and you said, I want prayer, we're going to pray for you personally, lay hands on you. The Bible says that if there are any sick among you, and that doesn't have to just be sick physically, sick and mentally, sick emotionally, to lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. And so we're going to pray for you. But if you're in this place and you say, you know, it's just not me, we're going to pray a prayer. And right afterwards, I'm going to dismiss you. You're welcome to pick up your children and go. But if you want to just stay, I'm going to ask you to do something. The band's going to sing as the pastors and the leaders pray. And I want you just to continue to pray. The Bible says that when two or more gather together as touching anything, that what they ask in the name of Jesus shall be done. I want to ask if you'd just be so bold as to grab the hand of somebody next to you and just start praying. Start praying for the people that are up here. Start praying for the generation. Start praying for the broken. Start praying for your family. Start praying for your city. Start praying for your church. Start praying for the Spirit of God to move. And let's gather together and let's break the back of the spirit of depression. Let's break the back of the spirit of suicide. Let's break the back of the spirit of death in this Inland Empire. Yes, and they might want to say this is a place where people go to lose hope. But we say this is a place in the name of Jesus where people come to find life. So yes. Let's join together and let's pray. Father God, yes, we come before God. You. Holy Spirit, we invite you to just move in this place. Just move to blow through with the wind of healing in the name of Jesus. I pray that people will leave their burdens here at the altar. They'll leave their depression here at the altar. The spirit of suicide and the spirit of death, the spirit of anxiety. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would remove it in the name of Jesus. We say that no weapon formed against this church, no weapon formed against the people of God shall have any ground ground to stand. The Word of God says that we, the saints of God, will rise up, Lord, and that you would raise a standard against the devil and that he would flee. And so, Father, we say right now, in the name of Jesus, the spirit of suicide, the spirit of depression, the spirit of anxiety, get out in the name of Jesus. We cast you out of this church. We cast you out of this valley. We cast you out of these cities. We say this is a place of life. This is a place of healing. This is a place of hope. This is a place of deliverance. And this is a place dedicated and founded on and to Jesus Christ. And so, Father, we surrender our will. We surrender our desires. We surrender our passions. We surrender our emotions to the will and to the ways and to the desires of Jesus in our lives. And we invite Jesus and the Spirit of God to come and move in this place. Move in our lives. Lord, I pray that you would be miraculously begin to turn the stories, turn the weeping into dancing, turn the crying into laughing, turn the weak into the strong, to take the hopeless and make them a useful and a testimony to those who are around us. And the Word of God says, you have given us the Spirit of God, the Spirit of comfort, that in our times of duress you would give to us, so that we would give it to those who are in need. So the Spirit of comfort, as you fall upon this place, Holy Spirit, I pray that you would take it, that we would take you with us, take you to our schools, to our families, to our workplaces, to our friends, wherever it might be, that the world would know that Jesus loves them, that Jesus died for them, and there is hope in Jesus' name. Amen, and amen, and amen. At this time, pastors, youth leaders, prayer leaders, board members, reverends, if you're in this place, we want you to come and now pray. So if that's you in this place, we want you to stay. If you want to leave, you are welcome to leave. If you want to stay in worship and stay in the presence of God, you are welcome to stay. But let's continue to pray that the Spirit of God moves in this place. Now, as you exit, the people up here, listen, I'm talking to you guys up here. We have resources. Chad Daniel and Joyce Myers have teamed together and given to you resources. We have 500 copies. Now, this is for you guys. We have 500 copies of Joyce Myers' book about forgiveness for you as you exit, after you've been prayed for. Now, this is you guys. I don't want everybody to take this. This is for you guys. As you exit, I want you to exit. Look to your right-hand side. Over there is a big welcome area. We have resources. For those of you, we have 500, Chad, 500 copies of that Youth Bites video. One per family. Please take one. Take it and spread the word. Share it. That's for you to take, to give it to somebody, to share the gospel and the love of Jesus Christ, to display and to show and reveal there is hope in your life. So we're going to pray, and as we do, the band's going to sing.
Worthy. fervently. Pray with a passion. Grab a hold of somebody's hand and start praying for whatever the Lord leads you. Let's bring this place down in prayer in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Still getting prayed for. Hey, you stay, you hang out. But we're going to conclude. We're going to wrap it up. We're going to finish for tonight. We just want to say, listen, you got it here, but it doesn't stay here. It goes. Spirit of God goes with you wherever you go to carry, to minister, and to be ministered to. So as you walk out of this place, remember, you're carrying the Spirit of God on you right now. So Father, I thank you for the saints of God. I ask that each and every person that here was here tonight, that is still here, Lord, I ask that you set a hedge of protection about them as they walk out of this place. Lord, I pray that you would call them blessed. I pray that you would speak life to them this week through your Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done in this place, that we make the proclamation and we stand on that word in Jesus' name. We thank you for that. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.